you don't powder it on, you don't do any of that, you just smooth it off. It's just so slick, and you can fill them in a heartbeat.
How do you seed though? Like, do you hand seed each one of those?
No, that's, well, we'll transplant each one, but when we seed it, we'll use this cedar that we have.
That's like a tomato or a retail thing that's going on to a bigger size. 128
cedar. So we shake the seeds on here, shake it out like this with a vacuum, and it sucks into the holes. And then on the back side of it,
I don't know if you can see all those little holes. Mm-hmm. Where's the light?
And then on the back side, you adjust the amount of vacuum. So
they go in here and it holds a seed on each one of those things if you've got the right size.
Okay. And then all you do is, once all the holes are filled, you just come back and you just turn it up like this, tap it with your hand, and it knocks out all the ones that are doubles.
And then you set it up and turn them over and put them in this little blue thing.
And then you just go right back to...
And then you put it over your flat and turn this thing and they all release. Yeah.
And then you turn off the vacuum.
Okay. Yeah, there's a little... This is going to be a lousy recording.
You normally wouldn't pot up your lettuce.
I normally do not.
No, you pot up much.
Occasionally, when we would do an order.
Oh, tomatoes, peppers. We do thousands and thousands of peppers and tomatoes. Not for our use, potted up, but for farm market.
For retail. But for on-farm stuff, you're not potting up much.
I do for my indoor tomatoes. We do probably 600-700 of those every year. So we actually get those finally up into this size with a stick holding them up, and we have one of those max tires, and they'll be that tall. When we sit them in the ground, they'll be that deep in the ground.
Our favorite retail for like herbs or tomatoes, peppers, things like that for retail is this size pot. It's deeper. Kind of a pain in the neck because they fall over.
But
when they're getting them, I mean, they're in the tray now that they don't, but when they're getting one or two or at market, they're kind of, or until they're watering, until they get them in the ground, they're very top heavy. But with our soil mix, where we're not using fertilizer and stuff, they make a great, just perfect sized plant.
Yep.
And everybody says, a lot of people will say, retail people say, I got tomatoes from you and somebody else, and this is so much better. When you're getting a conventional thing, there's transplant shock because until the roots get in the ground, there's nothing happening. They're waiting for their daily, you know, sheep manure fix or their daily whatever fix, you know, conventional people are giving them. They're like, what happened? And ours, you know, are not like that.
Something I did leave out, about pretty near the time when this thing starts to germinate, not necessarily lettuce, but I try to do everything. I will hand water with a 1 gallon water mycorrhizal fungi. And I try to do that on every flat that goes out, whether it's going to us or going to someone else. And I usually go with, I'm sorry?
The powder you buy? Or
yeah, I get it from mycorrhizal application, I think is the name of the company. And it's their endo. And it's their fine grade water powder mixture that they have. Stuff works great. The difference, sometimes it's almost too extreme this time of the year in the greenhouse with the tomatoes. They grow too fast. And like my one customer up in Holmes County, he's coming on Tuesday, and he was actually asking how big they were, because last year they were like this tall, and it was right now, and I planted them like the first week of January. But that much growth is a little scary. You got to keep it's a balance between light and cold and all these other things. So we try to run the greenhouse hotter at night than it gets in the daytime for just a short while. And when you do that, you inhibit the growth of the plant. It's called dip. It's something one of the conventional tricks. But we also use fans. We also take all the tomato plants all the time, every day, almost, and brush them with our hands. And that little bit of movement
makes them stockier.
Yeah. Makes them shorter.
You can also soak any of your plants either, or it's all overhead water. And do you soak any of your?
No. Anytime I soak them is when I'm getting ready to pull the plugs. I might stick them in
just to get them
just to really get them wet so they cool. Because otherwise you might get stuck with them, depending on how long they've been in the plant.
If they're at the sweet spot, you know, done enough, but not too done. If they're too done, they get a little stickier or they fall apart a little bit.
And not all plants are the same. Some of Leslie's flowers, oh my gosh, it takes a, it's like you just have to have the fix a good amount.
And some things don't seem to like cell, these cell packs. They seem to, I don't know, like.
That's
true. Do you use the same mix when you plant up to a larger size?
Yes.
Yeah.
Prevent.
Yeah.
And what do you do pest control wise?
Okay, pest control.
Thank you.
I don't do anything to speak of anymore except the biggest issue you'll have is when we were doing bedding plants on a large scale, we were getting in cuttings from all over the country. You have two problems. You have systemic poisons potentially on the plant, which. Now these are ornamentals, so but I am worried about my organic greenhouse because every time one of my predators or parasitoids would go near that thing, it would kill it. Mm-hmm. The other issue
I'm still thinking about how he thought every bug we ever had came
well,
from
that's
ornamentals.
True. Aphids seem to be.
We still have bugs.
I don't have white flies anymore. All I have now to deal with is aphids, and I release. Aphidius, wasp.
We still have some fungal gnats. And
yeah, well, the fungal gnats we'll never get rid of. And
but
the
we're not to worry about.
Aphidolides is the midge that I use. Aphidolides.
And we have had mites.
And the mites came in. I don't know where the mites came. I've had them for years. This year, I think I finally got rid of them with another predatory mite. It was a Californica something. And that one seems to have taken care of the problem because it had jumped into my tomato production in one of the greenhouses. The white flies I don't have anymore, I think mostly because we don't import plants. That one is really, those are tricky little devils. And if you have those, you're going to have to go with sticky tape to figure out who you have, and then you can go with some mixes of, they have strips that you can hang little things and they'll hatch out and they'll go after them. That's been probably 6-7 years since I've had.
Do you use trap crops at all?
Outside, but not
inside.
No.
I'll tell you, I have a 52-by-21-foot geodesic biodome. It was a 12,000-gallon indoor pond with aquatic plants, and I have everything from house plants to succulents all in the same space. Oh. And we just got to the point where the humidity level, because obviously it's very well constructed. But it just got to the point between the aquatic plants hatching things almost on a daily basis. We just put eggplants and Gerber daisies and all the things we knew that would draw the white flies, and it did make a tremendous amount.
You picked two of the best to put in there.
Yeah.
Huh? You picked two of the best, that's for sure. Huh. So that made a big difference.
It made a big difference.
I know I have eggplant this summer. I put eggplant, and that's where I was finding all my mites finally going to that area.
Right. Well, I got the idea when I used to work wholesale at greenhouse. The owner, he would go and set 3 or 4 flats of eggplants at the end of each range that had whitefly problems.
You could do it with
they were spraying. He was a conventional guy,
right.
But they were spraying, and you know, on top of that, but if at least there was. Some hope for some of the range.
Once you start using beneficials, and this is really hard for all of us to do, you've got to stop spraying any soap or anything. They're extremely sensitive.
I had no
aid once I had my tomatoes outdoors this year. My plants, when they go out the door to my customers, they'll have parasitized aphids on them. So they're inoculating their gardens with these guys. It's great. It's great stuff. And it's expensive. I mean, I probably put $1,200 a year or more into it, but I don't have to worry anymore about spraying that stuff. I hate spraying soap. I hate spraying any of it. It's all bad for you. I mean, I know it's legal, but none of it's good for you. And all the powders are even worse. I mean, then you got to worry about that dust inhaling. It's not worth it. So, yeah, beneficials. BioBest is one company I use. I used to use Copper, now I use BioBest. They seem to have a really good product. They're consistent. I don't know who you buy them from in Ohio anymore. I think you can get them from BFG.
Arpico is in Michigan. There's several.
I've got one guy I've been dealing with, and he used to actually come to this conference. He was in Ohio, Richard Gephardt. Gerhardt. Yeah, and actually he set up a booth here years ago, and that's when I met him. And he sells all the stuff. It's International Technology Service, T really a bogus name. It's, you look that up and you'll end up looking up tons of other things. But if you find anything under that heading that talks about biologicals, he's the guy.
What do you say?
International Technology Service.
Because it's ITT. Shows up on
technology.
Shows up on the credit card.
Okay.
So I don't know. So.
You get them BioVet.
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 BES. And it's got a little data back.
How long have you guys transplanted? Like, we started early, but the greenhouse isn't heated.
Attention, please. Workshop session 2A is now ending. Workshop session 2A is now ending. Workshop session 2B will be starting in 10 minutes. The next workshop will be starting in 10 minutes.
So if you have other questions for Deb, you can go into that, like, outpost towards the parking right at the end of the hall. And I'll carry this stuff out, get it out.
What's that EC meter? The conductivity meter? What's that conductivity meter called?
It's called a conductivity meter.
No, I mean, what brand?
What brand do I have? I have a Milwaukee, but I bought it like back in the 90s.
Oh.
Yeah, what do you have? Hannah? Yeah, Hannah's probably as good as any now.
Yeah, because the one that I...